Hey guys, it's Leanna, and I'm here today to talk about the mortal engines. I know I'm being super dramatic, but I have this red scarf. My mom just gave it to me, and I was like, this is, like, literally perfect, so I have to use it for this. Anyway, I'm here today to do a book-to-film critique analysis type of deal. I've never done that before on this channel, so first time for everything. And since I read the book and just saw the movie, I decided to do it. So here we go. There's going to be a loose structure to this. I'm kind of going to start with what the movie got right, like what was the same as the book, then what things they changed, so what they got wrong, and then the end will be my analysis of how everything went wrong. So spoiler warning, the movie was terrible, but double spoiler warning, this video will be spoilery for both the book and the movie because I'm gonna go into, like, beginning to end what happens in both, how they're different, and how the movie was garbage. Okay, so let's start with, again, what went right, i.e. like when they were true to the book. So far, everything I'm gonna tell you in this part is what's true in both the book and the movie, so I won't specify because this is true in both. So if you don't know, the premise of The Mortal Engines is that this is like in the distant future, in a futuristic Earth world where like 1,000 years ago, during the 62nd war, humans decimated like the Earth. It's not super specific on how we did that. It's sort of from context because you sort of get the feeling it was probably like a nuclear war type of deal. And so we kind of ruined the Earth all that time ago. And because the Earth was so unstable after that, this premise is dumb, but this is the premise. The solution for this was that cities became mobile. So the entire city could move around because no place was stable enough for people to stay physically in one place. I mean, obviously, the solution here is not for an entire city to be mobile, it's just for people to constantly be mobile, you know, or like more caravan-style living, not having a giant city on wheels. But fine, that's the premise and that's the reason. So despite the like weirdness of that premise, there are some cool things that become possible with that premise. So having this like mobile, you know, city, like having this whole group of people moving around, like there's some interesting ideas that they can work with based on that premise. It's just you just have to accept it and just go from there. So this is true in both. And our main characters, there's four main characters, and this is more true in the book, but it is also true in the movie that these are the four main characters. You have Tom, who works in, he works in the like historical archives department of like London. And then you have Catherine, who is the daughter of this famous archaeologist in London. He's kind of like a hero of London. Then you have Bevis, who is this young man who works in the engineering guild. Sorry, I should have said the historical guild is where Tom works. They're all called guilds. And Bevis works in the engineering guild in London. And then the fourth character is Hester Shaw, who is that girl. And she's not of London. She's the only one of the four that's not. These are the four main characters that you follow throughout the story. Again, true in both. And the way that they all become part of the story is that Tom goes down. London has just captured another city because these are predator cities. So they go around capturing smaller cities, like chasing them down for their resources because resources are limited. So it's kind of like Mad Max, but with cities. So they've just absorbed a new small city. And so, Tom gets sent down because, they tend to just sort of use everything for parts or for fuel. So the historical people want to preserve artifacts from like old Earth, from like our time. So he's sent down to sort of find stuff that would be of historical significance before it all gets used up for fuel or for parts. And when he's down there, he meets his hero, Valentine, who's again, this famous archaeologist who's down there with his daughter. And Valentine gets attacked by this girl who just came off of this new city that they captured. She's Hester Shaw. She attacks Valentine. Tommy's like, oh no, this is my hero, I can't let this happen. B, this is my chance to prove myself to my hero. This is my moment to shine. So then he stops Hester from killing Valentine. And then when she flees, chases her down. And Hester, before she's about to jump off of London, tells Tom that Valentine killed her mother. And she shows her face to him. And this is kind of true in both, that Hester has a very scarred face. This is more true in the book, but Hester has a scarred face. And so she falls off of London and Tom is shook. Valentine catches up with him and is like, what just happened? And Tom tells him what the girl said, what her name was. And Valentine pushes him off the city because he knows too much. And then Catherine catches up and is like, what happened? And Valentine's like, I'm so sorry. Like, I know you liked that young guy, Tom, but he fell because that horrible woman pulled him off. And Catherine's really upset about it, but she notices that there's a young engineer who was standing nearby and probably saw everything. And she finds the engineer because something is fishy about this. And she's like, "That my dad's not telling me everything." So she finds that engineer, Bevis, and the two of them start investigating stuff on their end of things in London. Meanwhile, Tom has fallen off of London and is with Hester. And Tom's mission is to get back to London. Hester's mission is still to kill Valentine. And Catherine wants to figure out what her father's up to. And Bevis, who's this young engineer, is jazzed about hanging out with Catherine and also has seen some weird stuff that he can't explain. So he's down to help her out. So that's true in both the book and the movie. And that's kind of where the similarities die. So in the book, after Tom falls off and is hanging out with Hester, there's a series of really interesting adventures they go on because they encounter other moving cities, people that Hester knows from before, and Tom slowly starts to have like his blinders peeled away because he's been so hardcore, like, London is the best thing ever, my hero Valentine is the greatest thing ever, and there's nothing wrong with my worldview, predator cities are the best way to go, blah, 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 and Hester's evil and horrible and whatever. And Hester's like, Valentine pushed you off the city, are you kidding me? Are you still pro him? So it's a long journey for Tom to come to terms with the fact that maybe, just maybe, London isn't great and maybe Valentine isn't so great because maybe he did actually kill Hester's mom. And maybe he did really push him off of London. And meanwhile, there's Catherine and Bevis in London, and same sort of similar journey for them as well, where Catherine is slowly piecing some things together. She's heard the name Shaw, so she's looked it up in historical records. Hester's mom is somebody famous. She can't find Hester's name. She's piecing things together with Bevis's help, and Bevis is an engineer, so he's on a lower tier of the engineering guild, but he's like, yeah, there's some higher ups that have been doing some stuff that I'm not allowed to know about. So they sneak in and they figure it out, and that's their end of things. And the whole sense in the book is that everyone at first is like super like, London is great, except all of a sudden Hester shows up and just throws everything out of whack and starts making everybody question everything. Whereas in the movie, the moment you see Valentine, he's got like Snidely Whiplash, I'm evil vibes. And Tom is already, before he even sees Hester, is already like something's fishy going on. And he's like collecting evidence because he's already like, there's something up, like there's something they're keeping from us. So when he meets Valentine for the first time, they kind of do this whole hero moment with him, but it doesn't really work because he's like all like, he is a fan of Valentine's, but also he's already suspicious about something going on in London. He doesn't think Valentine's part of it, but you know what I mean? He's not so, like, gung-ho. Then another big change is that Hester, she is scarred in the movie, but if you've seen the trailer, she's got, like, one, like, line. It looks like there was, like, a cut on her face at some point that healed badly, and that's it. In the book, her face is, like, half gone. Like, her nose is missing. Like, she is a mess. Like, stuff of nightmares, horrific. Like, her face was chopped off, basically. So when Tom sees her for the first time, he's like, yikes. Whereas in the movie, she's, like, still a really pretty girl. She just kind of got this scar situation. Another big change that they made in the movie is that, while Valentine is clearly an antagonist in the book, in the movie, he's the ultimate villain. So in the book, Valentine has been up to some things that are questionable, and he did kill Hester's mom. But he's been working for the Lord Mayor of London. And so as his daughter pieces this stuff together, she's like, I can't believe my dad would do this. And when she confronts her father about it, he's like, well, I did it for you so that you would be safe and fine and accepted in London, even though you're an outsider. She's an outsider. It's not super gone in depth, but she's an outsider. So he's like, I did this so that, you know, we'd have a place here and you'd be safe. And she's like, at what cost? And he's like, maybe you're right. And so he, in the end, has kind of like a Darth Vader style, like, redemption moment, which in the movie he doesn't. He is the ultimate villain. There is no villainy person that he's working for that's worse than him. He is top cuckoo crazy villain. Another big change is that they changed the ending of, this is the super spoilery part. So at the end of the book, when there's this redemption moment for Valentine, Hester has returned to London after this, all these adventures that she and Tom go on. She's returned to London and she's making to kill Valentine. And Catherine sees this and sees that her father is actually about to kill Hester because he still wants her dead because she knows too much. And Catherine feels it's her responsibility to save Hester because she feels responsible for her father's mistakes. So she stops her father from killing Hester, but she gets killed instead. So, and then there's this huge weapon that Valentine's been involved in building for London, and that's the evil stuff he's doing. So Catherine and Bevis have already put a hitch in those plans, so the weapon is malfunctioning. And so Bevis dies because the weapon is malfunctioning, and Hester now, because of this whole Catherine's dead thing, she kind of feels bad for Valentine because he's like tore up that his daughter's dead, and she tries to save Valentine because London is imploding, and he's like, nah, it's too late for me, and he dies holding his daughter in his arms, and Hester and Tom escape, and that's the end. In the movie, there is no redemption moment for Valentine. Catherine doesn't die. I'm not sure what happens with Bevis. I'm not sure they even like show us, because he's kind of like not an important character at all in the movie. He's like just kind of in there to like kind of be around Catherine, but that's kind of it. And then Hester escapes with Tom, and Catherine also escapes after discovering her dad is cuckoo crazy evil. And yeah, I don't think we ever see what happens with Bevis, and it's just like, doesn't matter. So those are the major differences between the two. I kind of already started edging into what went wrong, which I kind of didn't want to. I wanted to just be straight changes, but it's so hard because those changes are dumb. So now we are going to move into full what went wrong, because yikes. What went wrong? The book already is kind of an iffy premise. I did not love the book. I want to be clear about that. I don't know why I'm holding this book in my lap. I was gonna hold it up while I talked about it, but okay, well, I'm talking about the book now. It's not great. Like, it's a pretty dumb premise, but there's a lot of little things about it that, like, it's the dumb premise does allow the author to do some cool things, some cool ideas and cool questions about humanity and blah, blah, blah. So the book has some redeeming aspects. The movie just shat on those. Like, I don't even know why. So the book already is very short, and honestly, reading it, it feels quite cinematic already. So, you know, when people like have trouble with like the idea of adapting a book to a movie, they'll sometimes be like, well, you know, this doesn't really lend itself to being on film, so this is gonna be tricky. This already feels like it's been written for the screen or with the screen in mind. It's very visual. So if they literally like page by page had adapted it and not changed anything, it's already pretty much cinema ready. You just add a soundtrack and you're good to go. But they changed a hell of a lot, and I don't know why, because all it did was it took out anything that might even be emotionally significant, and without that emotional significance, none of the action matters. Because if people are like fighting and dying, but you don't care about those people, it doesn't matter how cool your graphics are. So I kind of touched on it already, but so Hester's face is a fucking disaster. Like, in the book, she's like the stuff of nightmares. So this is a huge part of her character, because she saw Valentine kill her mother, and then Valentine is the one that did this to her face. So that's something that you would never really be able to get over, because you see it every day. It's affecting you on a minute-to-minute, day-to-day basis. So that grudge is something that you're physically carrying and seeing. In addition to that, then people react badly to her whole life. So she's very hostile and distrusting of everyone, including obviously Tom, who stopped her from killing her arch nemesis. So it takes a long time for Hester, when her and Tom kind of start hitting it off and they're kind of more allies now that he's come around to the idea that Valentine might not be so great and London might not be so great. It takes a long time for Hester to accept the fact that someone might actually be her ally and not because they're trying to use her for something. Because Tom is like super bright-eyed, bushy-tailed, and innocent. He was totally like, London's great. And now he's like, wow, London might not be so great. And his motivations where Hester is concerned are like, well, I gotta help her, and we're a team now, and I gotta save her. And so she's like, why are you helping me? I wouldn't help you. It takes a long time for her to accept that he might actually be trying to help her. And that is not a thing in the movie. In the movie, yes, she's got a scar on her face, which has marked her, and she has this grudge against Valentine, but this absolute distrust of everyone based on her appearance that she has to get over isn't something that she has to really truly get over in the movie. And so they don't even play it up as like where she is getting over that and it's kind of just unbelievable because she's not that badly scarred, but they act like she is. They don't really act like she is. Like, they're just kind of like, oh, whoa, like what happened to your face? And like one lady at some point says something about like, oh, you got enough scars, honey. But she looks fine. Like, she's hot. Let's be real. She's hot. And she's, okay, she's got, like, a weird scar, but whatever. She's still hot. And it's not something that the, like, character is displaying either, like distrust and hostility based on her appearance. Like she's just kind of generally gruff, but not any more so than anyone that who'd be kind of roughing it would be. So it's not like this whole thing to her character is just gone. So the fact that she does end up allying with Tom doesn't seem like a big deal because she's like, yeah, okay, you know, we've been hanging out, and so I guess I can trust you. It's not this big thing with her. And then with Tom, the fact that in the book, he's completely innocent and gullible and believes that everything is great in London and then has to realize that it's not. That's a huge thing for him and his character to have to get over and accept that maybe life isn't as perfect as he thought and that he's questioning everything that he believed. That's a really important thing for him too. And part of, he can't trust Hester if he's gonna like continue to believe in London because those two things are mutually exclusive. So in order to be able to begin to trust Hester, he has to begin to accept that what she's saying is true and that his hero is not his hero and that London is not great and that they're up to something evil. So like she has to get over her mistrust of other people in trusting Tom and he has to get over his belief in the goodness of London in order to work with her. And so these are like kind of huge deals for these characters to overcome and then bond over and then work together towards defeating Valentine and saving, well, it doesn't go so well for London, but you know, it's something that they really have to struggle with, overcome, and that is much more compelling. In the movie, he's already suspicious when you first meet him. He's already like, there's something going on in London and I'm like, I've been starting to store hide things because the people are like, it's going missing and I'm worried about it. So when he first meets Hester and she says that things are like not so hunky-dory and that Valentine's evil, it seems silly that he would not immediately agree with her because he's already been suspicious. So the only way they get around this is that he's just kind of like goofy and that he doesn't really have experience and he's just kind of doesn't, it's more of like the, that he's just kind of like ignorant and doesn't know how to survive is kind of the only thing they do with him. That he's never had to rough it before, never been off the city before. So she's just kind of like, you're annoying and you're dead weight. But there isn't this like crushing like realization that what you believed isn't true, which is a big deal in the book. And so there's just no emotional impact for what these characters are going through. So when they bond in the movie, the actors are good actors. And I think they could have done a good job, but the plot didn't. Like, they changed the plot too much, so these characters were stripped of their emotional arcs, and it was just, they were just shells going through the motions for that reason. Then, with Catherine and Bevis, they're like literally half the book. If not completely, then almost. They're given equal time as Catherine and Tom, and so when they die, it's not like they were throwaway characters. In the book, they actually were kind of throwaway characters. So if they died, we wouldn't have cared. And then they don't even die. So that you don't even get that emotional impact. In the book, Catherine obviously believes her father's great. And Bevis he also thinks Valentine is great because he's a hero of London. And so they're slowly realizing that there's something going on. And as they slowly piece together what's going on, and they're building this weapon and that, oh no, what are we going to do about it? And like, oh shit, like this is bad. We got to put a stop to this. It's the two of them sort of like doing all this digging, like they're on the hunt, they're on the case, and they're like putting clues together and piecing it together based on what they know. So you're following through this like mystery as they're piecing it together. In the movie, they kind of already know what's going on. Bevis is already hostile and suspicious, and he doesn't really want to help Catherine. And then he kind of grudgingly agrees to do it. And they kind of immediately discover what's going wrong. Everyone kind of already seems to know about this weapon. Everyone's already suspicious about it. Even before they've investigated everything, everyone who's evil has already walked on screen being like, I'm evil. So there's no sense of discovery, no sense of like, we're discovering, there's like a mystery and like, we need to piece it together and what's really going on here. It's obvious who's a villain. It's obvious they're up to something. It's obvious where they're doing it. And it's obvious what our characters are going to come to find out. So there's no sense of mystery. You're like, you guys are idiots. And then there's another character that they made a huge change with. So when Tom and Hester are going on their, now they've fallen off London and they need to find their way. There's all this sort of thing where they fall into like this smaller city where they're going to try to sell them off as slaves. So they have to escape. And then this woman is got an airship and they try to book passage. And she's like, well, how are you going to pay? And he's like, I can't pay. And then she sees that these slavers are after them. She's like, you know what? Just come with me and I'll take you away. Cause like, I don't want to see anybody get enslaved. And they go with her and Tom is like innocent and gullible. So he just tells her all about London. And then later he finds out that she's probably an anti-tractionist agent. And so an anti-tractionist, they're these like this group that's against these moving cities. They think that's a bad idea. And so they're pro like staying in one place like a normal city should. Anti-tractionists are like this rebel group. And so later, like when it comes to light that she probably was one, And he's like, but she didn't seem like an agent. Like, she didn't seem like she'd be like this like rebel or whatever. That's so wrong. And Hester's like, why would an agent like seem like an agent to you? They wouldn't be a very good agent if they seemed like one, which is an excellent point. And it's hilarious that that literally happens in the book where Hester's literally like, you'd be a terrible agent if people looked at you and immediately knew you were one. Because in the movie, if you've seen the trailer, that Asian woman with the sunglasses, that's that character. The moment she walks on screen, she's like, I'm an important rebel. And as soon as you see her, you're like, the name is Bond, James Bond. Like, no stealth. In fact, her face is plastered all over London as like a wanted criminal. So the moment she shows up, it's like, bang, bang, bang. Like, I'm a rebel and I'm gonna like rescue you. There's no subtlety. There's no mystery. There's no reveal. She's immediately recognizable as a rebel. And she takes these people away. So there's no like mystery. There's no discovery. Everything is told to you immediately. So there's like no point. There's like, you already know. You know what I mean? And then there's a whole scene, like whole passage that's cut out, which I thought when I was reading it would actually be really fun on screen, and they totally cut it out, where Hester and Tom get captured by this pirate city, and they're probably going to be enslaved again, except that this guy who runs this pirate ship discovers that Tom is from London, and he's like, oh, you're from London, because this guy, when he acquires enough wealth, he wants to be legitimate, he wants to be taken seriously as a gentleman, so he wants Tom, who's from London, to teach him manners and etiquette. And that's like this whole funny thing that super reminded me, if you've seen the movie Stardust, like the part where they're on the ship with Captain Shakespeare, and there's this like, they're pirates, but they're like this like fun kind of crew, and there's this like weird adventure and whatever. It gave me those vibes, and I thought it was a little darker and a little more violent and less silly, but it kind of reminded me of that. And I was like, that'd be really fun on screen, because the whole book had this sort of like quirky, like violent things are happening, but also there's these like sweet, innocent people. There's these like strange, quirky jokes. It had like a Terry Pratchett vibe at times, especially with the pirates. The movie was literally just like CGI and no emotion, occasional attempts at humor that fell flat, because there was no story backing it up where you'd already care about the characters and then the humor adds to it. It was just like a bunch of action, then an occasional throwaway line where you're like, I guess that was meant to be funny. And then again, like the fact that Catherine dies as well as Bevis, you've spent a lot of time with them in the book. Whereas in the movie, they're just kind of, she's kind of a hot girl and yeah, she's Valentine's daughter, but that's it. And you at the end, she's alive and she's fine. And she doesn't seem that shook up about the fact that she's discovered that her dad was like an evil psycho villain. She's like, that's wrong. And then everything is fine. Again, in the book, you had this epic Darth Vader type moment where he was like the villain's right-hand man, but he has this moment of clarity for his child. Like, this is literally paralleling Star Wars, where like, because of his daughter, who is like the Luke Skywalker in this scenario, is like, this is wrong. And he's like, you know what, you're right. And it's not too late for me to do something about it, except that it is too late and he dies. So that all is stripped away because Valentine is just this like comically evil villain who is still psycho and evil at the end and just says evil things just to be evil and then dies. And I was like, why? Why would you do that? His character was so much more interesting and so much more layered when, you know, he'd gone too far down the path of I'll do what it takes to protect my daughter. And he had stopped being able to draw that line of what is too far until his daughter was like, yo, this is too far. And he's like, you're right. Which is much stronger than in the movie. And I don't understand why they would change that. Now, the one scene that is not relevant like to either plot that much, but I just have to bring it up because I literally started laughing in the theater. Like, I think they were mad at me because I couldn't contain myself. I was cackling. So this epic end battle when they're going to go in and try to like stop London from using this epic weapon they've been building. And so London has shot down a bunch of the rebel ships. And this rebel woman that you've seen in the trailers, who is obviously Miss Rebel, she's like, but I have still my ship. So they're going to board her ship and use that as like a last ditch effort, bring Tom and Hester over there. And earlier in the movie, there's this throwaway line about how once upon a time, Tom had wanted to be an aviator before he like was part of the Historians Guild. And like, they kind of mentioned that and then not really that much anymore. So right as they're about to board the ship, like it's go time, like London is about to like kill them, like activate Death Star, go. And he, like, they're all boarding the ship, and then he turns and he sees all these like aviator jackets pegged on the wall, and there's this like slow scene where he's like looking at them, like drooling over them, And then he slowly approaches the jackets and reaches out and like strokes one of them. And I'm like, are we doing this right now? And then they cut to the inside the ship where they're like, where's Tom? We gotta go. And then they cut to him and he's like slow-mo walking on the ship wearing his jacket. And I was just like, are we doing this right now? You got your jacket? You ready to go? Because you're all gonna die now. Like, what? Why? Like, am I meant to think this is emotionally significant and epic and, like, be into it? Am I supposed to laugh at it because he's being silly? Like, I don't even know what tone they're going for here. It's dumb, though. Like, whatever tone it was supposed to be is a dumb tone. It's a dumb thing to have. And why is this here? Likewise, like, in the beginning, it did have this, like, quirky vibe, which I was, like, at first I was, like, okay, like, I like what they're doing with this because they did throw in a lot of, like, the fact that they're gathering, like, historical artifacts from our time, and so they have these like statues of minions and they call them like the deities of the ancients, because like if you don't know and you just dug them up, you'd be like, these are statues, like we must have revered them. So there's this display in the museum of like the gods of the ancients, and they're like minions, and like they have like handheld devices, and they talk about how like we didn't have the written word in our day because like we just have these flat screens and we don't know how they worked. And I was like, okay, that's cool, like those are some cool ideas. And that's kind of how the book is too, because one of the artifacts that Tom collects is a CD, and like they talk about how like they don't really like, they believe the ancients use these to store information but they don't really know how they work, and like he uses that as barter because it's a valuable rare artifact. So like those are some cool things that were both in the book, and they started out in the movie kind of doing those things, and I was like, okay, I like this, where you're going with it. They give up on that like the moment Hester shows up, and then it's all just like dramatic glances and like epic CGI machines and stuff with like no character development, just epic battle scenes with a bunch of people walking around posturing like, you should have been known who I am, I'm a rebel, I'm here to avenge somebody, I want to be a pilot. And you're like, you guys are a joke, like why? The book had tons of action but also like a good character arc. And I haven't even mentioned the, like, there's this whole side arc, which is probably one of the most interesting things in the book, and they did include it in the movie but wasted it, was that there was this like cyborg thing that had saved Hester as a child, and now it's been unleashed by London to go after her and kill her because it says that it wants to kill her. Except the thing is, it wants to kill her so that she can be turned into the thing that he is and be preserved forever as a thing of metal, because like, unless someone destroys him, which they end up doing, he's, like, this machine that has, like, no emotions, except obviously he does, because he cares about her. But he keeps saying he wants to kill Hester, and London is like, great, you're gonna go kill her, that's what we want. But he wants to kill her because he wants her to be remade and be immortal. And so when he encounters them and says that he wants to kill her, she's like, why would you want to kill me? Like, we're friends. And he's like, no, then you can be like me. And he's about to kill her, and Tom stops him from killing her. And she's like, why did you do that? Why would you stop him? He was like, he was about to kill you. And she's like, I wanted that. I wanted to be turned into this machine. Because, like, she already feels like no one cares about her. She would rather feel nothing and go out and kill Valentine. That's still where her brain is at. And Tom's like, what's wrong with you? You're so selfish. Like, I care about you, so I saved you. Like, you're welcome. And this, again, is, like, a really emotional moment. Because she's saying, I would rather die and be turned into a machine because, like, that would be better than what my life is. And she can't accept the fact that Tom would care about her and that someone would care about her and that that's a reason to live. And this is an epic moment. And then in the movie, the thing goes after her for the same motivation. But there's not this... She already knew in the movie that he wanted to turn her into those things because that was something they had agreed on when she was a kid. She broke her promise to him to become that thing when she discovered Valentine was nearby and was like, oh, gotta go after him. And then he's like, you left, so like you still owe me for this. And then she decides that she doesn't want to be that thing because she loves Tom. And when the machine finds out that she loves Tom, that breaks his heart, and he like literally dies of a broken heart in the movie. He like crumples to his knees. And I was just like, are you serious? Like, this was so much more powerful in the book, and I don't know why you changed it. You didn't have to. It's not any different cinematically. So I was just like, why? It was this dumb moment where they like that flash this montage of like her as a kid and her being with this machine, and then this flashes of her and like her and Tom being in love, and I was like, I'm not buying that because you guys have no chemistry. And it was just that all this music they were playing, and they just really drag this scene out where like he's dying of a broken heart. And I was like, I know I'm supposed to feel something right now, but I definitely don't. And then Catherine doesn't die, and Valentine is super crazy and evil, and the whole thing was just a huge mess. Basically, every choice they made weakened the plot, weakened the story, weakened the narrative, and it was cinematically beautiful. It was absolutely spectacular. The effects were super cool, and it was a gorgeous film that had no soul. It had been totally stripped of its soul. It was laughably bad, and I don't know why, because if you had literally just taken the book and word for word put it on screen, it would have been fine. Because most of those action scenes, like, if those aren't in there, there are plenty of action scenes in here that they didn't put in the movie. So if they wanted a lot of action, there's a ton of action in the book. And it also has some character development and some growth and some emotional moments. And they, like, try to manufacture emotional moments, which is really silly when there already are really emotional moments in the book. Just put those in there. It'd be different if the book was just, like, bare bones and, like, a lot of science. And they're like, you know, people need some emotional moments, so we're gonna put some in even though they're not in the book. No, the book has more emotional moments. So they created these random ones that weren't in the book to have emotional impact, when they could have just left the ones from the book in there, and those would have worked so much better. So in summation, if you're gonna see the movie or read the book, I recommend reading the book. It's not super long. The audiobook is pretty good, so if you want to listen to it, that's also, it's not, I think it's like 5 or 6 hours. It's an audiobook, it's not very long. But yeah, it could have been super cool. Like, it would still be a dumb premise. There's no getting around how dumb the premise is. But if you accept that premise, I've seen movies with dumber premises. As long as, you know, the rest of it holds up and is interesting and you care about the characters, you can have a dumb premise and people will buy it. You just have to make it worth it. And they did not make it worth it. That movie was, it was just so sad to see all those resources wasted on this huge, big budget, spectacular looking movie, which had good actors in it. I don't fault the actors. I like all the actors who played Tom and Hester and Bevis and Catherine. They could have all played the characters. Hugo Weaving could have played Valentine. And Hugo Weaving, we've seen play a more complex character where you have a redemption arc, and he could have played the shit out of that. And it would have been so much better. And it was such a waste of Hugo Weaving to have him basically be Snidely Whiplash and just like, I'm so evil. I'm like, why not let the man act? He can act. Give him the more meaty role of somebody who's done a lot of bad things and finally, you know, draws the line when it's too late. Like, that's so much more powerful on screen as an actor, as an audience member. Like, why? Why would you, like, castrated the story? They, like, completely stripped it of its meaning, of its soul, and just did a bunch of action, which, at that point, why even make it the Mortal Engines? Like, you're not interested in any of the, like, story of the characters. You're just in it to have these cities rolling around attacking each other Mad Max style. So why even call it the Mortal Engines? Just do your own thing. Let me know in the comments down below if you've read the book, if you've seen the movie. If you enjoyed this book-to-film kind of critique, it's never occurred to me to do this before, but it was kind of fun doing it, especially because it was so bad, so I had a lot to say. But if you like this kind of video, I can do it again, because they make book-to-film adaptations. So I can do old ones if there's ones you want to see me do. I'd be glad to, if that's something you like. Or if you never, ever want me to do this again, you can let me know that too, because then I won't waste my time. Anyway, let me know in the comments down below, anything and everything, and I'll see you in my next video.